Whilst you muse over the output, as far as the songwriting is concerned, I have to sort of yank you immediately back to Brand New Key.
Sure.
How did that happen?
That particular song came right after I had been on a 27-day fast on nothing but distilled water. I was up in Escondido, California. I had problems with meat. You know, I thought, well, I mean, if you can survive without eating it, then, you know, it might be better not to eat it. And so I was, you know, exploring all different kinds of vegetarianism. I was every kind of vegetarian. I was, you know, a fruitarian and a vegan, but they didn't have that word then, lacto-ovo. And I fasted for 27 days. I didn't want to stop. I was in another state, really. I mean, you start leaving your body, basically. You get into a state very much, I guess, like you would on heroin or morphine or something. Your perceptions are amazing. And I mean, I remembered toward the end of that fast, putting on television, my senses were so assaulted. There was a Marcus Welby episode, which was really terrible. I mean, melodramatic and silly and under normal circumstances, nothing would have affected me. But in this fasting state, I was so sensitive. I cried. I cried and cried. I went to a restaurant with other people, and I cried. I cried for the state of the world. You know, it was just, everything was so, your nerve endings are so attuned to some kind of other reality. It was just, I loved it. I wrote a lot of songs, and I was loving it, and I didn't want to stop fasting, but first you begin with a tablespoon of partially cooked carrot and partially cooked raw zucchini and a little bit of juice, and just very gradually you introduce food back into your system. What you need to have to survive well will occur to you. But I didn't mind eating meat. It was just the thought of it that bothered me. I went back to my house in New Jersey, and I was on my way to an early morning flea market. You know, one of those 4 a.m. where you take your flashlight and give me your dealer's price. And I went there, and I was on my way home. We went past a McDonald's, and I smelled oils and the rancid thing. And I don't know, it brought all these memories back to me of roller skating down Suicide Hill. It must have been a snack bar in the area at the time. And I said, you know, I want one of them. I want one. I'm going to go over there. Can we go over there? Stop. So we went in. I had, you know, the whole little McDonald meal with the fries and the fiberglass milkshake and everything. And I had the burger. I no sooner finished this last bite of burger, and that song just popped in my head. So when Jim Juddelson of Gulf and Western, who was distributing our record label at the time, said, write another one, I thought, are you crazy? I wrote it as a one-off song. It just came to me in this memory of skating down Suicide Hill and breaking my tooth and roller skating and bicycle riding and all those images of New York and growing up there, and just popped out like that, out of the hamburger.
After Woodstock, you play the Isle of Wight Festival in England. And of course, that year was a vintage year for the Isle of Wight as well. The last performance from Hendrix. How did you find that one?
Well, I became kind of festival queen. The phenomenon of me at Woodstock was that I went on the stage unknown, and I came off of that stage a celebrity. I mean, it was instantaneous, really. That was the catalyst. It just put me into, you know, a whole other echelon of performers. You know, I was now on stage with Jimi Hendrix and Elton John, and well, of course, that was before he actually became Elton John. I was festival queen. Everywhere there was a festival, I was contacted to do the festival. There was Strawberry Fields and Goose Lake and all the festivals that followed Woodstock. Isle of Wight and Glastonbury, and later on in Denmark, and all over the world. I was the festival lady. Once I did the Isle of Wight, I had like 3 records in the top 10 or something. That I followed the Who. Nobody wanted to follow the Who. I was in a caravan that Donovan, it was a beautiful old gypsy wagon with carvings and a beautiful wood-burning fireplace, stove, you know, a little stove. But the problem was the fumes, because it was freezing. I was freezing. It was cold and damp, and it had to keep warm, so the fumes were horrible, and I was coughing again. The tragic figure in some old melodrama, you know, coughing, the tubercular cough, you know, ready to just expire. You have to get there by hovercraft and all other kinds of things. I'd never been in a hovercraft before. And we went over with all the people going over. You know, it wasn't an exclusive hovercraft. It was just public hovercraftness. And that's when I thought of the song Good Book. Poor little hairy kids out on their own. They ran to a festival to show they were one. And they've fallen in love with all humankind. So tell them you love them so they don't change their mind. That was that song. Came from that experience of traveling over with these backpacks. And I get there and I'm led to Donovan's gypsy caravan. And I spent the whole day there and met the Who, and Keith Moon gave me his drumstick after he performed, and they were very gracious and funny, and everybody was very nice. I didn't realize some of them were hitting on me. I was very naive about that stuff. I never knew. I was always the last to know about that. And also dirty jokes. I never got dirty jokes. I was one of those silly, you know, huh? Why are they laughing? I don't understand. You know, classic bimbo, you know, reaction to most of that stuff. I really never knew. I just didn't know. I led a sheltered life. I don't know. I'm in my own little world. Didn't understand that stuff. Now that I perceive what I perceive, and I'm jaded, and I do understand the worldly ways, and I try not to, but I do.